Hello, and welcome back to another weekly video. Recently, I was scrolling through my extensive list of games when I noticed that Plasma has had a few updates since I last played. Not only has it had a few updates, but it's introduced a simple solution to one of my primary problems with the game. If you didn't know, the Plasma physics system uses articulated bodies to simulate joint movement. That means the joints are very rigid, unlike some games, but also that there is, or was, no way to attach a creation to itself. This update added a joiner tile, which creates a temporary physics connection between two creations, or, more importantly here, between a creation and a different part of itself. Anyway, what this means for me is that my list of ideas for Plasma has gotten a lot more viable. The first thing to do was to actually make sure that the joiner worked how I expected it to. I placed on a platform with a motor at zero torque that would act as close to a bearing as I think is possible. Onto this, I added a series of pipes with two joiners and a motor at the other end. After setting the joiners to instantly join, what I was trying to achieve here was to have the motor on the left spin the pipes. That wouldn't have been possible before this update, but as you can see, it was perfectly doable now. With this knowledge in mind, I set to the topic of this video, creating an engine. In order to make the crankshaft, I started by placing a bearing down on one side. I got this simple U-shape for the first piston in, and after moving around manually, you can see that the zero torque motor isn't a perfect bearing, as it doesn't keep the momentum like you'd expect. I realized I would need the piston to rotate independently, so after fixing that, I duplicated and rotated the whole assembly to add a second piston. Next, I wanted to know how the separators worked. This was another tile added with the joiner that allows you to separate parts of a creation on command. In particular, I wanted to know how it affected collisions, because I would need the engine's pistons to collide with the walls to keep them in line. As you can see, when a creation is separated, collisions affect it just as I would expect. You can also see that the joiners aren't perfectly rigid pieces, they're more like scrap mechanic bearings because they flex under load. I was worried about this, but it didn't end up being much of a problem. I also learned here that once a creation is separated, there's no way to reattach it without doing it manually. This was fine, but it meant I would have to attach the pieces by hand every time. Back to the engine, I started to build the piston itself. I placed on a long pipe with a thruster on top, at which point I also decided to brace the other side of the shaft with a bearing and joiner. I realized at this point that if I wanted the pistons to collide and stay in line, they would need to be on a separate creation. My solution to this was to build a separator and joiner inside of a kind of chuck that would hold the crankshaft in place. Importantly here, look how I'm placing this separator inside of the chuck. I didn't notice it at the time, but the separator does have depth, and this placement actually made the entire crankshaft slightly off-center. You can see how this will work now. Before separation, the crankshaft falls straight through the platform, and afterward it collides. Looking at the joiners, I could tell that the shaft wasn't centered properly, so I was going on a chase to figure out why for about 10 minutes. I even checked every single piece to see if one was slightly rotated, before finally realizing. My solution to this was to add a second separator facing the other direction to equalize that gap. After that, I added an identical chuck to the other side of the shaft, except this one would not need the separator. Now it's detached and... why is it rotating? Oh. As a reminder, none of the motors were powered. This rotation was completely due to physics interactions from the joiners. Fortunately, after trying it again with no changes, it worked properly, but these intermittent issues never quite went away with this chuck design. I added a basic support in the middle of the shaft and started to build up a proper piston head. This organization of blocks looks pretty funny, but it actually meant that the bearing was perfectly centered above the piston arm. With a basic piston head on, I added the walls for the cylinder and placed a thruster on top. If I put a thruster up here, at a speed of like 10, how much that is. Wait, that's not a thruster. Get out of here. I also wanted to see the piston, so I tried to add a glass wall instead, only to find out that there isn't any kind of tileable glass. I tried to use this glass window, which sort of worked, but I eventually reverted to solid blocks. No. I hate this. Why is there no glass? After duplicating the first piston, I realized that the piston arm was too long to travel past the chamber, so I decreased its length. That still didn't quite work, so I thought I would just build the chambers so they didn't interfere. This did work, but was pretty complicated to modify during testing. At this point, I found out that the thrusters are actually pretty weak for this application, and there isn't really a way to decrease friction that I found. A single thruster per piston just wouldn't be enough. I modified the piston slightly and made the crankshaft offset smaller, and it did help, but I was running into other issues with it binding and the shaft falling out. By the way, in order to troubleshoot here, I did set the outside motors to rotate. After making a bunch of small changes and not seeing much progress, I decided to see if I could use plasma cannons to fire at the pistons instead of thrusters. This would be slightly more realistic and way cooler, which is important. These did seem to at least be a little more powerful than the thrusters, but their inconsistent output made them hard to deal with, and they were still running into the same friction problems. I was sort of out of ideas here, so I decided to rethink the way I was doing the crankshaft entirely. My first idea was to try to avoid using the joiners at all, and just resting the shaft inside of these supports after detaching. This didn't not work, but the high amount of downward force consistently won the battle against physics and caused the shaft to pop out. I did mess with that a little more before inevitably deciding to use joiners again, this time using the raw motor block as a bearing because I could actually remove damping, though I don't think it made any difference. It really didn't like this and decided to scrap mechanic itself away. A bunch of minor adjustments later, including making the piston arm thinner to avoid collisions, it was working as well as it ever had. Which is to say it wasn't working. As one final push for this concept, I checked to see if plasma cannons could give momentum to the objects they're attached to, which unfortunately they still cannot, unlike thrusters. With that clearly not going to work, I went to rethink my initial concept again. As a reminder, in order for the pistons to collide with the cylinder, they need to be separate creations. This time, I was going to try to make the cylinder walls detach instead of the crankshaft. Really, I should have done this from the start because the walls are under much less stress and therefore will hold with the joiners better, but now I know. I also decided to encase one end of the walls in blocks to hold them in place better. You can see how this works now. The walls detach from the base and are held in place with joiners. The crankshaft is held onto the base by direct attachment to the bearing on the right. Though I change almost everything else, this concept is the one I use in my final design. I set the motor to rotate the shaft again so I could test collisions. This allowed me to see that it wasn't being properly supported and was actually getting pretty twisted. To fix this, I added a sort of through-bearing post on joiners to support the center of the shaft. One side was supported by the base and the other was in line. I spent a ton of time troubleshooting why this kept getting stuck at the same position, to the point that I actually decided to redesign the piston head and gave it an internal bearing because I thought maybe that was the problem. Oh, it's glitching into the adjacent block and then hitting the pillar, I see now. Yeah, in summary, on the way down, the piston head glitched just slightly into the walls, which caused it to land on top of this crossbeam, even though they're supposed to be flush together. This is another thing that's obvious in review, but took nearly 20 minutes to figure out. The solution to this was simple enough, though. I just had to make the walls one piece, which you can tell immediately fixed the problem. There we go. I assembled the whole shaft back together and made the new walls fit the old one. With the pistons themselves mostly working, now I wanted to move on to trying to sequence them properly. My first attempt here was to use distance sensors to detect where the pistons were in their rotation. I kind of worked something out here, but it didn't end up being very effective, so I scrapped this. Next, I considered that the engine pretty much had two states, piston 1 on or piston 2 on. I had this button flip between the two. Even with no sequencing, the engine never gets enough momentum to fully turn over, which no amount of sequencing could fix. This was sort of the last big hurdle to get over, and there are still 2.5 hours left in my recording. At first, I thought that maybe if I gave the engine more mass to turn over, maybe it could keep momentum, like a flywheel in a real engine. All this did was make it unstable to say the least.
Well, that's certainly not where that was supposed to go.
I realized that it was always getting stuck at the same point in the cycle, right before the left piston made it on the bottom, but the other half of the cycle kept momentum fine. I thought maybe it would be better if I just gave it more thrust, so I tripled the thrust per piston, I then also wired these all up the same way. This didn't really seem to fix it at all, but did make the problem more visible. It zooms around the entire cycle until it reaches left piston down, 180 degrees from the start, and then loses all of its momentum. In an attempt to figure it out, I set the motor to spin again. Using this, it became even more obvious because the piston sped through the entire rotation before barely making it past that point. I even removed the first piston entirely, which actually seemed to fix the problem. Until I flipped that and removed the second piston, which also seemed to fix the problem. At this point, I was getting really quite frustrated after over 45 minutes of not being able to find the cause of this problem. I tried removing and replacing parts, expanding the pistons, shrinking the pistons. At one point, I even added counter thrust just to pretend it wasn't a problem. Even after the whole thing had been ship of Theseus, I still had no idea what caused this. That was until... Oh, wait, no, I never actually figured it out. I decided to just add a third piston so I could force it through the difficult spot. Even after all of that, one benefit of plasma is that duplicating the piston was very simple. All I had to do was copy it and expand the piston walls, and then I had a 3-cylinder engine. Though adding a piston would fix the problem I had with friction, it also added quite a bit of complexity. I had to rotate each piston 120 degrees so they could contribute power at a different part of the cycle. With that, I also had to rotate the piston arms themselves so that they could start inside the chamber, which is easier said than done. I definitely could have done some pretty simple angle math to get these to fit perfectly, but instead I decided to wing it. I initially thought that it would be pretty simple to sequence these because there would always be two pistons on at a time for a total of three states. I hard-coded this logic in to test it. Each of these relays represents a different one of those states. Testing this with buttons, though, it simply didn't work. In this state, the two outer pistons are on, but they're actually on different sides of the shaft, so they're working against each other. My three states idea wasn't correct. I tried instead to wire each button to a different piston, which almost worked. For some reason, though, the engine kept cycling back to a default position when I stopped applying thrust. I assume this has something to do with using motors as bearings, and it may be the same problem I was having before. Even as soon as I spawn the creation in, it wants to rotate, so I have no idea what causes this. When I apply thrust quick enough, though, it does turn over, so once I get the logic in place, it should work. In order to turn over, each piston needs to be active when on one side of the shaft. To get this behavior, I decided to use color sensors. I placed four color sensors on one side and painted each piston a different color. The wiring looks pretty complex, but really all of this logic here is to combine the four color sensors into one color signal representing which pistons are on that side of the shaft. I can then break down that signal into the RGB values to determine which pistons need to be active at any time. If that signal contains red, the closest piston needs to be active. If it's blue, then the second piston needs to be active, and green for the third piston. Interestingly, I also found out here that color sensors actually take lighting into account, unlike games like Scrap Mechanic. So if a sensor is pointing at a bright white surface but there's no light, it'll be reported as black. This was causing some misfirings depending on the angle of the engine to the sun because that would change the colors, so I eventually added some floodlights on max power to keep them always illuminated. This doesn't normally happen, but with that, it just started to work. Oh my god. It's working. You can see how each piston breaks the blue beam of the color sensor as it goes around, so it knows which one to activate. To exaggerate the visual effect, I put a ceiling so you can see which thrusters are active as it goes around. The engine was actually pretty powerful and didn't have trouble rotating even all this mass. Because of this, I wanted to test a handful of other things, including a gearing system, which, annoyingly, also requires parts to be detached so that they can collide. I also tried to use it to power a car, but the joiner system isn't quite stable enough for that yet.
Oh my lord! What about the rest of it? Where did the rest of it go?
I never did find the other pieces. Anyway, I'll leave it there. I am incredibly happy with this design, though when I couldn't figure out that friction problem, I almost gave up. Definitely let me know if you have any ideas for that. If you enjoy this video, please leave a like and feel free to subscribe. If you're interested in another video like this, you can click the card on screen or check out my channel. This is probably the best engine I've built yet, and though my videos have been few and far between lately, I have a bunch of ideas for Plasma. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, and goodbye.